And our school is located in Kahala. It's been, hula has been my life, and I'm really excited about me having this interview for my two young ladies. Let's see. It's really amazing that you did pick the word, the aloha, because my kumu hula, her thing was the aloha, ole. And if you cover this, so what it means is akahai means to be modest. Lokahi is to have unity. Ou is to have harmony. Ha'aha'a to be humble. And ahunui to have patience. So she really, this was her signature, Aunty Nana Kalama. And everywhere we went, we always have to do it. So if you cover that up, it spells aloha down here. So that's what, to her, this really was a wonderful word. She loved it. Okay, so I'm going to begin with my background. My background of hula included, of course, Auntie Mikey Ayure, my first teacher. And then after Auntie Mikey, I studied with Auntie Nana, who unikied me as kumu hula. And of course, Uncle, the master of hula, Kimo Ke Olana. He's really, I hope you have the opportunity sometimes. He's wonderful. Oh, he's great. Okay, so I grew up in Nu'uanu, and I'm Nu'uanu Pa'oa area, and that's where Auntie Mikey started her hula at the church, at a church, Hokpa. And so it was there that I started hula, and I think I must have been about 9 years old. From there, Auntie Mikey always invited us to do shows like at the military, which is the, what is that hospital with? The Tripler Hospital. We did a lot of shows there. We did a lot of shows in the community as far as church luau's. So that's how I kind of started. And then Auntie also had a venue at the Halikulani Hotel. And then she got invited to have dancers go to New York at the Lexington. So I had just graduated high school. So off we went to New York. Well, actually, we went to Chicago first, and then New York. But that was really, it kind of changes you because life is so fast. And here I'm coming from Hawaii, and everything is so slow paced. So our shows were like, oh my God. I mean, you're just in and out, in and out. But it was a good experience. And so from New York, after our 3 month engagement there, they asked me to stay, but I thought, oh no, I don't think so. I better go home. Anyway, came home and hooked up with Auntie Mikey again. And she was still doing the shows at the Halikulani. And here we are backstage, and it's like so slow paced. It was like, hooey, are you girls ready? That was so cute because, you know, in New York, we're just flying in and out of the dressing room. And here we are, I'm home, and I'm thinking, oh my God. But anyway, it was wonderful to have the experience of being away. And it was good to come home. But I just found everything so, you know, slow. Anyway, as time went on, I was asked to perform at the Hilton Hawaiian Village Tapu. I was there for I think 17 years. We had Auntie Hilo Hattie as one of our stars. Lani Casino was our lead dancer, and she was a beautiful dancer, Lani Casino. We had wonderful musicians, Uncle Benny Karama. Oh, I can name them. I mean, they're legends, of course. And then we had Masako. Masako was a girl that she was a Japanese girl. And she had really large eyes. And Mrs. Flanders, who was the entertainment director, kind of picked up on the fact that when Masako came on stage, she was dressed in a kimono, and she had the lights just shining right on her eyes. And she would, and that's how that she started. And she did Knack the Night. Anyway, that was a big hit. She became real popular. And not to change the subject, but getting back to Mrs. Flanders, she was the dance director at Kunal. I don't know if you girls remember. In fact, the dance school is named after her, Josephine Flanders Dance Pavilion. No, she passed on, but she was really great because she taught me a lot of pacing as far as putting a show together. She taught me a lot without me realizing. I was her secretary also, so I was around her a lot. I was able to put shows together for her. I was able to hire people for her. And so that kind of led me into the show business. And so pacing was really interesting because I didn't realize that I could do it until I actually had to do it. And so anyway, that was one thing, but Mrs. Flanders was really a great mentor to me. How has hula evolved? That's really interesting because when I was dancing, hula had already evolved from what it was. Because, you know, now here we come, and we're doing Yakahula, Ikadula, and that kind of stuff. So for me to be at this age and to see hula where it's at, I think it's kind of gone back, and yet I'm the kind of person that I really enjoy. I enjoy production. So when, like Johnny Lumho, I mean, I think his things are really interesting because he makes it interesting, he makes it exciting. And of course, some people in the hula world think, oh no, I don't think so. But anyway, I enjoy his work, and that's where I'm kind of, and also Patrick Makuakani, he comes from, you know, San Francisco, and he comes a lot here. And to see his shows, it's really off the wall, but I enjoy it. And so you cannot put it down because it's not Hawaiian, but you know, so if you want to stay in the Hawaiian realm, that's fine. You know, like, it's a lot of people get put down for it, for not, you know, not being Hawaiian. But anyway, that's where I'm in between. I'm, you know, I'm for the way it is now and the way it was. So either way. What was my most memorable moment? The NFL had come to Honolulu. This was for the Pro Bowl. And so there was a young man that was doing a Kalani Pocket. He was with Hawaii Visitors Bureau. And I think after a while, I guess different directors come in and they want new people. So they had approached Danny Kalani, and he came to my brother and I and said, you know, you folks want to direct and produce the Pro Bowl. I thought, what? Oh my God. But anyway, we did take it on, and it was really interesting. And again, when there was a turnover of commissioners, we did it for like 7 years, and it was really every time the Pro Bowl ended, I was already thinking of what to do for the next year. So we did some, I thought, really wonderful productions, and at that time the commissioner behind me, oh gosh, he was a wonderful man, and he really loved Hawaii. And I remember going, when I had a presentation at the stadium, because I wanted the dancers to come down in the audience, they called me in. I had no idea I was being set up, but I sat in on this meeting with everybody from the stadium and the security, and I thought, wow, at that point I thought, I think they're setting me up here. So sure enough, they started, you know, like, Moni, you can't have the dancers in the audience because they drink, people drink, and you know, that they went on and on and on. And I was sitting there thinking, oh my gosh, now they're telling me that the Pro Bowl is next week. In the meantime, I had ordered all these tons of TVs for the dancers that were coming into the audience. And so I quietly thought, okay, I was real calm, and I don't know how I was so calm, but I said, well, who has the last say? And I can't think of his name. Anyway, he's not here, but Mr. So-and-so, and he has the last say. So I said, okay, well, can we wait till he comes? Anyway, so he comes in, and they present him, you know, the Leimomi wants to do dancers, and we were kind of against it. So he looked at me and he said, well, how important is it to you, Leimomi? I said, very important. I said, I ordered all these tea leaves, and I said, so it's important. He said, well, how long is the concept? I said, well, probably, I would say maybe not more than 5 minutes, where the dancers would come down into the field after they perform. And he said, let her do it. When he said that, I mean, the people in the stadium, I thought, oh my God. I mean, they just, in fact, the manager at the stadium, he just walked out of the meeting. He was so upset. But I mean, I thought, oh, and so a lot of the workers there, they came up to me after, they said, how did you do that? And I said, no, I didn't do it. I said, but I guess he realized how important it was. And I remember that particular show, that I could hear the people in the audience going, where are the dancers? Oh, look, they're over there. They're coming down the stairs. So it was exciting, you know. And so that was a really good, so let's put it this way. At that point in my life, I had decided that I didn't think I wanted to be a kuhula. I want to direct shows. I want to put it together. And then we got asked to replace the Casamiros at the Monogram. And to be real honest with you, those shows were really exciting. I taught the numbers, choreographed the show, but I was up in the light room, and I was up there, you know, telling the light man, calling the cues, you know, curtain up, curtain down, and so that I was getting really excited, because now here comes another part of my life that I didn't think was, you know, going to happen, but here I am. I mean, I'm not teaching. I'm still working with hula, but I'm doing another concept, and I really was enjoying it. But then NFL, like I said, they had their own line about, and that I could never understand. Why do they have to bring mainland people in to our islands to teach or do things with us. Thank you, it was a good ride, and what an experience. And that was the end of that. So then after the shows with the Casimiros, we also did Kahala Hilton when Danny would go on break. And so I choreographed those shows, and anyway, that part of my life I thought was gonna excel, because I thought that's where I wanted to go, but I came right back to hula. So here I am today. What does hula mean to me? Well, it's been my life, so it's like I enjoy it, I love it. I'm happy to have had the opportunity to do it. What inspires me is to choreograph and create hula numbers. And I know that most of the ladies go, "Oh my God, Lingua, that's so beautiful. I love that motion," and so forth. So that's really, it helps me. And it's funny because, you know, I used to spend hours trying to work out a routine, you know, and put it down on paper. But I can't do that anymore. I mean, I just do it. And it's like, it just comes naturally. I don't know how to explain it, but even I get surprised sometimes. And of course, I have to constantly remind my babies that even though now I have helpers in the front, I have ladies that have unbelievable memories. I can only create, I've created thousands of numbers, so I can't remember them all. So I always tell the ladies, I choreographed this number, but it's not that I can't remember them all. So I need help with most of the ladies that especially a Japanese girl. She has just a phenomenal memory. And there's nothing that she can't, all the songs I've taught, I can just ask her right on the spot and she knows it. So obviously she practices a lot. What do you want to pass on to you? The love of hula. Yeah, I think so. And what inspires your hula teaching today? Like I said, well, the younger children inspire me, but it's not easy working with four-year-olds. It's kind of frustrating at times, but basically, I mean, they're the future. And I can just pick out the girls that I know are gonna just do it. And I can look at the others and say, oh, I wanna tell their mothers, you know what, I don't think this is for her. But in all, they all enjoy it, I enjoy them, but it really takes a lot of patience, which is, in your aloha, ahonui, is patience. If you were taking hula for me for 5 years, and then a dancer came in, I would always give the girls that were there first the opportunity. It's automatic. I mean, I have a little girl, I think she's 7. She's in the competition line. She just excels. And she doesn't know the numbers sometimes, and she's with the girls, and she's just dancing. And I told her mother, I said, you know, she's an exception, you know, to the rule. So it's all right, And then I can see the development. Some girls will come in, and over the years, I get really disappointed because I'm thinking, oh my God, they can't. But all of a sudden, boom, you know, it just catches on, you know. I see them getting it, and it's like, oh, they moved on. So you can see them moving up the ladder, so to say. But I've always been that way as far as picking a solo dancer for a competition. And in my later life, I'm thinking, I really shouldn't do that. Yet they earned it. You know, they earned it because they were here from the beginning. And so why should I pick someone that just came in, that's a gorgeous girl, can dance, as opposed to a girl that has been with me, and you know? So that's the way I am right. But all of a sudden I'm starting to think, like for instance, this little gal I'm talking about, she would be perfect to have as a soul, in the Keiki division. But then I'm stepping on toes because I have girls older than her in that category. So I don't know. And I don't want to hurt the girls that have, you know, I don't want them to not have the opportunity to do it. And yet how do you do it? So as a result, at one time I used to do Keiki Hula, Hula Oni'e. I did several competitions so that all the girls could have a chance to do a solo. And then, can you imagine? It's difficult to have, because you're working with the costuming and the songs and oh my gosh. But that's when I was younger. Now that I'm older, it's like I only do what I want to do and what I can do. The word aloha really comes into play a lot as far as our lifestyle. We always say aloha with a greeting, or aloha when you say goodbye. So you've always picked the right day. And good luck.